Hello, North American Bitcoin Conference. Well, I guess, seeing as this is virtual, I guess it might be anyone everywhere. Citizens of planet Earth. I'm Brock Pierce, and I'm glad to be here with you today to talk about the road ahead. I'd like to give thanks to Mo Levin and the entire team that facilitates making this happen. I wish I could be with you personally. Today it will be virtually, hopefully. We will be able to gather in person again soon, but I hope you're well. We're living in a changing world. What's changing? Obviously, 2020 brought a lot of major changes to the world, a lot of those things driven by the pandemic. I hope that you made use of this time to get your house in order, both literally and figuratively, that you made use of the sour lemons that you received and you made some lemonade, because it was an incredible opportunity to change our patterns, to break our patterns. I mean, I know I spent a lot of time getting on planes, flying all over the world to speak at this conference, to have that meeting. The limited travel increased my productivity and it allowed me to break a lot of patterns. And you can still continue to do that if you haven't done enough of it yet. Hopefully we're nearing the end of this pandemic. And we'll be entering a new normal, hopefully an upgraded normal, at least based upon how we show up in the world individually to be the change we wish to see in the world and to support those things that we think are going to make an impact. So what are some of the other things that have happened? I'm going to give you a frightening stat, but 26% of all US dollars ever created were created last year. And so we already had a problem, the rate at which government money was being created and issued. Obviously last year did this in a massive way, and it's not limited to the United States. And clearly we're nowhere near an end. The money printing will continue. And as a result of that, a lot of things have performed well. It's probably the primary driver behind the all-time record highs of Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies like Ethereum. But people have been rushing into any alternative store of value. It's why the equity markets are performing so well. It's why commodities have performed well, because everybody is trying to get out of government-issued currency, things like the US dollar, because clearly, at the rate that money's being created, you want to be in something else. The American dream and the idea that we can create and do things to better our lives is where a lot of our hope comes from. And so my heart is breaking for all of these small businesses around the world that have suffered or failed. And these things don't just come back together again, even with stimulus money. When the band breaks up, it doesn't just come back together again with money. When things begin to open up, it's not like, oh, everybody just shows back up again. It's gonna be a long road ahead. The ripple effects of what happened last year, we're gonna feel for many years to come. There is not going to be any speedy recovery, unfortunately. There's also been the changing of the guard. We had here in the US our elections. We have a new administration, a new president and vice president, an entirely new cabinet. The Democrats have taken the House and the Senate. And so a lot of things are going to change as a result of that. Clearly, one of the other things that has happened in that election is the integrity of our elections have been called into question. And I think there's an opportunity for blockchain or technology to play a role in this, not only to ensure the integrity of our elections and our democratic process, but to also drive accessibility. We can bank from our phones. We should be able to vote from our phones, which will increase participation, not just in things like the presidential election, but our local elections. About half of eligible voters in the United States don't vote. And that's in the big ones. It's more like 90% in our local elections, which quite possibly matter more in terms of the impact it has on our day-to-day life. The First Amendment is the First Amendment, not the third, not the fifth, for a reason. Freedom of speech is essential to freedom, the ability to have a voice and for our voices to be heard. These last few weeks have been very alarming in terms of the impact on our freedom of speech. What the tech giants have done here, whatever your political beliefs, should be of great concern. The idea that the sitting president of the United States can have his voice censored means that we are all at risk. And this is something that's been going on for a while for those of us that have been paying attention. YouTube channels being shut off, all sorts of censorship, and hence why it's so important that we build censorship-resistant technologies. And thanks to many of you, those platforms are being birthed because we clearly need them, and we need them now. Other things to note is legislation here in the U.S. The federal government has been very slow to create legislation to support innovation, but that is not true throughout the entire country. I've sat now with legislators in Wyoming, Idaho, Colorado, Utah, Alaska, and the states are doing something. A state like Wyoming that historically was dependent upon coal and natural gas, they recognize the writing is on the wall, that those sources of revenue are disappearing, and they recognize that they're going to need to do new things to receive the revenues they need to support their states. And Wyoming is leading the pack. They've passed 19 laws to support innovation around financial services, speedy banking laws, incredible stuff. Thousands of new companies have been incorporated in Wyoming as a result of this. Companies like Cardano and Kraken have moved sizable portions of their business there. Who would have thought that some of the fastest growing unicorns and decacorns would have moved to Wyoming of all places? And this goes to show the states that as you compete and create more business-friendly environments, the benefits are real and they're there. And a lot of the states are interested in doing something really exciting stuff. And it's not just happening here in the US, we're seeing this around the world. Ideas like universal earned income or universal basic income have become popular in part thanks to Andrew Yang. I clearly have done my part. And we saw the first experiment. You know, these stimulus checks going out to every American was essentially a test of this. And so I think ideas like this, their time has come. I think they are coming to fruition to conquer the great wealth divide at a time where that disparity presents a very, very real risk to society. You know, when people are desperate, when people are, their backs are up against the wall, their values and principles become secondary to survival. And we have to find a way to look after each other. We can work from anywhere. You know, this was the virtualization of the office or the distributed workforce was a trend that clearly had been happening for some time. But COVID, forcing everyone to work from home, has accelerated that process. And we can now work from anywhere. Exciting things will come from that, specifically here in Puerto Rico, where I'm talking to you now. From 2012 to 2019, 1,500 people moved to Puerto Rico to take advantage of the taxes here. And the taxes are we pay 0% state and federal short and long-term capital gains, and we pay 4% on our ordinary income. And so if you're in crypto, Puerto Rico has clearly become a big hub. If you haven't been down here to visit us, I encourage you, I invite you to come visit. We've got key people from Polkadot, Tezos, Ethereum, Bitcoin. The list goes on, and you will be making the lives of Puerto Rican people better by being here. We can do good and do well and have a good time simultaneously, so please come visit us. Places like New York are having the opposite effect. 400,000 people have moved out of New York City. Half the businesses have failed. There's a $15 billion budget deficit. And so I moved to Puerto Rico because I wanted to, well, I committed my life to service, specifically to public service, and I needed some training. And so I wanted to go to a part of the United States that was suffering the most. New York is the part of the United States that matters the most. And New York is in for a very rough ride. I'm spending a lot of time there seeing how I can be of service, seeing how I can help, how I can assist the government, because what happens to New York doesn't just affect New York City, it affects the entire country, it affects the whole world. New York is the beating heart of the financial system of the US, and if New York falls, we are all in for a lot of trouble. Other big things happening in the world. China's digital yuan is there. The news is talking about it, challenging the US dollar's reserve status in the world. And this stuff is real. From having started Tether, this is what I envisioned would happen. And it is now here. This is a big deal. Security tokens also. You know, these have been around for a while. We did BCAP back in 2016. It's not a new idea. T0 is live along with others. But I really think that 2021 is going to be a year where security tokens start to really matter, because the first hurdle, the first barrier for this stuff to work was getting through the regulatory sort of frameworks. And that's now happening in the US with people with their ATS license. Switzerland, because of bank secrecy and the privacy, their banking industry is suffering. They're leaning in to try and make that a hub for this, as is places like Singapore. And so now that we've gotten through the, call it, major regulatory hurdles, the next part is curating, you know, the right deals. And there's some really interesting deals on the horizon. I'm excited by everything happening there. As you probably know, I ran for president of the United States last year as an independent candidate. I announced my candidacy on July 4th on Independence Day. Clearly, I had no intention of winning. I did this as an exploratory run to understand the mechanics of our political system, to understand the ways in which the system is rigged. And it is. I'll give you one stat that basically summarizes it very clearly. To run for president as a Democrat or a Republican, you need 25,000 petitions or signatures. As an independent, you need 700,000. I could talk to you for hours about this, but I think that stat, I think those figures tell you like how serious it is. And we broke a lot of records. Got 20,000 votes in a place like New York where, you know, a candidate that came in late. We've laid the groundwork, and it's created a platform for us to deliver important policy messages. You know, how technology is changing the world. And I hope that this administration understands how technology is a tool and how it can be used to make the world a better place. Want to highlight a couple of projects since we talked about censorship resistance. If you haven't checked out SenseChat, a blockchain-based messenger, please download it. You can find me there. And if you haven't checked out voice.com, make sure to check that out. Obviously, most of you, because it's been around a long time, Steemit and Hive, check those out. And if you're building censorship-resistant systems around social networking and messaging, this is an area that I believe is so important to our collective future. I'd love to hear what you're working on and see how I can be of service. We do have an ability to co-create a better future. I'm excited by all the things that we'll be able to do this year. Everything that we've worked on, it's becoming very real. Believe we can make a difference. We will. And we are. I'm Brock Pierce. Thank you for listening.